In this video, we'll study about the structure of the mammary gland. The structure of the mammary gland consists of three components. One is the glandular tissue. So these are the glandular tissue, which is of tubulo-alveolar type, and they are arranged in lobes. Then you have the fibrous tissue. So these white color fibrous tissues, so they support the lobes and they form number of septa which anchor the parenchyma to the overlying skin and underlying pectoral fascia. These fibrous bands are known as the suspensory ligaments of Cooper. The growth of malignant cells from the breast cancer may extend along these ligaments, and they produce dimples of the overlying skin or fixation of the lump to the pectoralis major muscle. Then you have the interlobar fatty tissue. So these yellow color things are fatty tissue. So these are interlobar fatty tissue, which makes the organ rounded in contour. Fat is, however, absent beneath the areola and the nipple. Now we'll see about the glandular tissue. It consists of 15 to 20 pyramidal lobes, each being drained by the lactiferous duct. So this is lactiferous duct. So the part of the mammary gland drained by one lactiferous duct is called the lobe of the gland. The lobes are arranged in radiating manner and they converge towards the areola, where the lactiferous duct dilates to form the lactiferous sinus. So this is the lactiferous sinus. The lactiferous duct dilate to form the lactiferous sinus, which possibly act as a reservoir of the milk. Finally, the duct opens into the nipple. Each duct drains a segmental system of smaller ducts and the lobules. Each segmental duct divides into a number of terminal ducts. From the terminal duct, numerous secretory gland pouch out to form a grape-like clusters. The area of breast parenchyma drained by one terminal duct is known as lobule. So this is the main duct which branch out, and this is the terminal duct. So the area of the breast parenchyma drained by one terminal duct is known as the lobule. The area of the parenchyma which is drained by one lactiferous duct is known as the lobe of the gland. Therefore, each lobe or the segment of the mammary gland is connected to individual lactiferous duct which contains numerous lobules. The lobules are surrounded by a breast-specific hormonally responsive fibrofatty stroma along with vessels and nerves. The lobules and their acini, they gain their functional maturity only with the onset of pregnancy. The duct possesses myoepithelial cells which rest on a basal lamina. Larger ducts are lined by columnar epithelium of two or more layers, and at the papillary opening they are lined by keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. The carcinoma of the breast usually arises from the larger ductal epithelium, whereas the distal smaller ducts are the sites of benign fibroadenoma. Next we'll see the structural differentiation of mammary gland, which varies with age, pregnancy and lactation. From birth to pre-pubertal life, it has only the lactiferous duct without alveoli. At puberty, the ducts undergo branching pattern and the peripheral branches form solid and spheroidal masses of cells, which are the precursors of alveoli. Next, in the pregnancy, during this period, further proliferation and epithelial growth of the terminal duct and the lobules takes place with increase in the number of alveoli per lobule. After about 6 months of pregnancy, the breast expands further due to increase in blood flow and secretion of colostrum, so that the total weight of each breast reaches about 400 grams. The secreting alveoli enlarge with the accumulation of milk, and the milk secreted in the later part of the pregnancy and for a few days after parturition is known as colostrum, which is poor in nutrients and contains fat globules and colostrum corpuscles. The colostrum corpuscles may be derived from the fatty degeneration of primitive alveoli or from the macrophage cells containing the phagocytosed fat. True milk secretion starts only after a few days of delivery with the suckling of the newborn. And during lactation, the distended alveoli are lined by single layer of epithelium, which is separated from the basement membrane by myoepithelial cells. The epithelium may be cuboidal in resting condition or columnar in lactation. Ultrastructurally, so this is an ultrastructure picture of an alveolar cell. The alveolar cell possesses basophilic cytoplasm, rough endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, ribosomes, Golgi apparatus, and lysosomes. And it has two types of secretory vacuole. One is the protein vacuoles, which contain casein and lactalbumin, and they are secreted in a merocrine manner through the intact cell membrane. And you have lipid vacuoles, which are discharged with the covering cell membrane and the cytoplasm like a apocrine glands. After lactation, when the lactation stops, usually 6 months after birth, the alveoli shrink and the remaining milk is absorbed and the glandular tissue returns to the resting condition. The hormones acting on the glandular tissue. The estrogen stimulates the growth and the branching of the duct. The progesterone stimulates the alveolar formation at the ends of the branching ducts. The placental estrogen and the progesterone helps in the formation of true secretory alveoli during the pregnancy. The prolactin and the growth hormone maintain the lactation. Oxytocin helps in the milk ejection initiated by the suckling reflex. The maternal estrogen circulating in the neonates of both sexes through the placenta stimulates the ductal epithelium of their breast to secrete a fat-free fluid in the first 1 or 2 weeks after birth. This is known as witch milk.